Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is David Greenstein. I'm Director of Public Programs at the Cooper Union, and I am very pleased to welcome you to this first lecture of our course on the Constitution today. More ordinary people voted to ratify the United States Constitution in 1787 and 88 than had ever voted on anything in the history of the world. Today, 228 years later, nearly every significant question that we debate in our political culture is debated by reference to this document. To discuss the lessons of the U.S. Constitution for contemporary America, we have Akhil Reed Amar of Yale University, where he is Sterling Professor of Law and Political Science. In addition to his latest book, The Constitution Today, Professor Amar is the author of America's Unwritten Constitution, The Law of the Land, America's Constitution, A Biography, The Bill of Rights, Creation and Reconstruction, and The Constitution and Criminal Procedure. If you didn't pick up a free copy of the Constitution, just like the one that was offered to Donald Trump a few weeks ago, they're available outside in the corridor and along with the course syllabus for the next 9 lectures. And Professor Amar's book and other books are for sale there. At the end, he will have a little time for a question and answer period. And if anybody would like a certificate of course completion after you have actually completed the course, get in touch with me and I will see that you get one. And now I'd like to welcome Professor Amar to the same lectern from which Abraham Lincoln made the speech, Right Makes Might, that propelled him to the presidency. Professor Amar.
Thank you very much, my fellow Americans. Our nation is at a crossroads in this season, a constitutional crossroads, a crossroads reminiscent in some ways of the crossroads that we as a nation confronted when Abraham Lincoln, that fellow over there, spoke at this very podium in another presidential election season. The momentous election this fall will affect profoundly the fate of our nation and the American constitutional project. It will affect it more profoundly than in most elections, perhaps as profoundly as the ones when Lincoln himself was on the ballot. The forthcoming election will, as I say, help determine the fate of our Constitution and our constitutional project, which was at the founding and which remains today, to borrow from Lincoln yet again, the last best hope of earth. I'll have a bit more to say about why I see the forthcoming election as eerily, uncannily similar to the ones when Mr. Lincoln was with us. But before I do, just a bit more about this free public lecture series, words of welcome and overview. This is a free series, and that doesn't just mean that there's no admissions fee. It means you are free to attend as many or as few of these lectures as you see fit. I'm not taking attendance. There will be no graded final exam, although I was delighted to hear that there is a certificate of completion that awaits. So it's a free series. It's a public lecture series, and with at least as much emphasis on public as lecture. Yes, I will be lecturing each week for 10 weeks in all, based on a book that at some point I'll tell you about, The Constitution Today. But every session is designed to facilitate your participation. I'm going to tell you what I really think. And I want you to feel free to disagree, to push back in the ways that Americans, you know, have always pushed back. So every lecture ideally will go for no more than 45 minutes, perhaps sometimes 40. I've set my alarm to go off at a certain point. And that's my way of telling myself to shut up and to bring you in. So it's a public lecture series. And as I said, it is a series. The series tracks a book that's just out today, in fact, called The Constitution Today. There are 10 chapters in the book, and there will be 10 lectures, each lecture corresponding to a different chapter. And and we're basically going to go straight, with two exceptions, on October the 3rd. There'll be no lecture, and there are constitutional reasons for both, you see. That's Rosh Hashanah. And I happen not to be Jewish, but some of you are, and I want to be deeply respectful and accommodating of your religious observance. We're going to talk about the role of religion in our Constitution and even in our presidential selection process, which is actually today's topic, our presidential selection process. So there are reasons we're not meeting on Rosh Hashanah, having to do with the respect that we Americans show to those of all faiths, and indeed of no particular faith. There will also be no meeting on the 7th of November, because that's the day before we make this momentous choice as a people, and I want you all to get a good night's sleep. And I want as many of you as possible to get out on the next day and help your fellow citizens vote, whether in this great city and state or elsewhere. So I don't want to get in the way of that. That's, from a certain point of view, I'm sure, every bit as important as Rosh Hashanah. So that's why we won't have, but apart from that, we meet every Monday. Bring your friends next time. So a free public lecture series, and the series ideally will build. Now let me go back and tell you a little bit more about why I see our current crossroads as somewhat similar, as eerily similar, in fact, to the one that our country confronted when Mr. Lincoln was with us. Just say that for a little bit, and then I'm going to launch into our topic for the first session, which is the American presidency, with particular emphasis on presidential selection, what the rules of presidential eligibility are in letter and spirit, and how that should inform how we think about this momentous choice that confronts us today. And you might say, well, wait a minute, I thought this was about the Constitution, and why is he beginning with the presidency? Because it's all about the courts. Well, no. Courts are actually only one branch out of three, and when you actually look at this document, they're third out of three. You know, it's the legislature, first among equals, then the executive branch, and then the judiciary. And you say, well, Mrs. McGillicuddy in eighth grade told me the most important constitutional decision ever was Marbury versus Madison. And I say, yeah, that's what I was taught too, but Marbury versus Madison is not even the most important constitutional decision of 1803. The most important constitutional decision of 1803, because it didn't say constitutional case, and you think that it's all about judges and cases and they're third out of three. The most important constitutional decision of 1803 is when Thomas Jefferson acquires Louisiana, doubling the landmass of the United States. And that's a big freaking deal and a constitutional decision. And presidents make constitutional decisions, and Congresses make constitutional decisions. And in fact, in my copy at least, even if you think judges are the be-all and end-all, presidents pick judges. Judges are not supposed to pick presidents. That's why Bush versus Gore was and remains a disgrace, and I'll tell you more about that in our fourth lecture, which is actually about the judiciary. So the first four, the first one's actually about the presidency, because in our world, the presidency as a practical matter in certain ways is first among equals. That's why we talk about off-year elections. Well, every member of the House of Representatives is on the ballot, and yet we call it an off-year election. That's the signal of the significance of the presidency. So we're going to have today's lecture on the presidency, and next week's is actually on the vice presidency, and we're going to talk about even what happens when, this is actually in the book, it turns out, unfortunately, to be ripped from the headlines, when even during an election season, if some untoward thing happens to a presidential candidate, some health issue, well, actually chapter two, lecture two, talks about all of that. The chapter is called Nothing But Maybe Everything. That's the nature of the vice presidency. The third lecture is going to be about the first branch, Congress, and how it's broken today, dysfunctional, and how we might fix it. Only after we talk about the presidency and the vice presidency and the Congress, I'm going to get around to the judiciary, as the Constitution sort of puts it a little bit later in its story. So those are our modern branches. And then we're going to talk about the culture wars in America, criminal procedure and guns, gays, race, affirmative action, Citizens United, all that uncontroversial stuff. And then a little bit more about what we, having talked about what divides us, I'll talk about what unites us and tell you a little bit about our constitutional project as a whole. I call it Remembering to Remember. It's a series of pieces that I compose in mid-September, because this is actually Constitution Week this week in our national culture. Maybe, how many of you knew that this is Constitution Week? How many, you've heard of July 4th, right? Okay. That's actually not the day on which we declared our independence, by the way. Who knows what day we declared our independence? July 2nd, right. We adopted the Declaration of Independence on the 4th, but we declared independence on July 2nd. And you know Flag Day, right? What's Flag Day? June 14th. Well, but there is this thing called Constitution Day, and it's when the Constitution went public in mid-September 1787. So this is Constitution Week, and I have a series of meditations every year. Sort of, I have my little Constitution sermon about what it is that we have in common: blue and red, black and white, male and female, conservative and liberal. So, and then I'm going to end the series with three presidential dramas. For each of our last three presidents, I'm going to talk a little bit about something that historians will remember as particularly salient about Constitution, about that presidency. So we're going to talk about the Clinton impeachment, and we're talking about it, you know, outside this hallway too, where we're back in the 90s again. I'm going to talk about George W. Bush's very odd election, his unpopular election in 2000, why we have the Electoral College, how we might fix it, what about Bush versus Gore, and then I'm going to talk about Obamacare, which is the constitutional drama, really, I think, of this president. So that's the outline of the series as a whole. Now let me just say a little bit more about why we're at a crossroads, and then I'm going to launch into the conversation about presidential selection. This election is extremely unusual. It's a rare, almost alignment of the planets, because this season, the House, the Senate, the presidency, and the Supreme Court are all up for grabs, in play. Come January, President Trump could be sworn in, and his party could control the Senate of the United States. And therefore, if that happens, they will fill the vacancy with someone of their choice, and therefore, there will be five Republican appointees out of nine on the Supreme Court. And they carry all of that. They're highly likely to carry the house, which, okay. So that is within the window easily of imaginable possibility, in the Overton window. And on the other side, it could be President Hillary Clinton. Cards on the table, I'm with her. She could carry the Senate, 50-50 chance, maybe even a little bit better than that these days. If she carries the Senate and if she wins the presidency, well, then it's going to be a Democrat-controlled Supreme Court. It's going to be 5-4 the other way for the first time since in a half century. Republican appointees have controlled the United States Supreme Court since 1970. First time in a half century that switch could happen. And it's even possible, although not likely possible, that if she wins big, she could carry the House of Representatives. Her party could actually win by 2 percentage points or more in the House. There could be 52 to 48 might be actually the vote for the generic vote for Democrats. 52% of the people voting for Congress people across the country could vote Democrat, and the Republicans could still perhaps carry the House. As happened, the numbers are a little different than that in 2012. So, but if she wins very big, if she wins by not 4 points but 8, 9, she wins the House of Representatives too. Now, so it's all up for grabs: House, Senate, presidency, judiciary. And that's part of the reason why it's a particular fraught time. And another reason, in two words, is Donald Trump. So that's why it's fraught. Now, how many times in American history has that been true? Well, let's start with Lincoln, who spoke here in this hall, because we have a two-party system, and we've had the same two parties since when Abraham Lincoln stood up here, and before that period, we didn't have the same two parties. We had Whigs for a while, and Federalists, and Anti-Federalists, and so our modern two-party system basically is born at about the time that Lincoln steps up at this podium and gives that very famous speech, and it's such an honor to be, in this hallowed hall. Okay, now in 1860, the Republicans have never won the presidency before. Their party is only basically, 5 years old or so, but they have a chance for the presidency, and indeed, it turns out they get it. And they can carry the House, maybe. They can carry the Senate, maybe, but they're never gonna carry the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court's been stacked by the Andrew Jackson party, and it's sort of overwhelmingly dominant. So, because you've had Andrew Jackson, Martin Van Buren, William Henry Harrison dies immediately, followed by John Tyler, who's basically a closet Democrat. Okay, another Jacksonian, James K. Polk, and then Zachary Taylor Millard Fillmore, a little Whig interlude. Again, Taylor dies. The Whigs die very early, the Whig presidents, and then. Franklin Pierce and James Buchanan. So Democrat, basically. And so when you have all these Democrat presidents, you're gonna have an overwhelmingly Democratic Supreme Court. And so Lincoln begins with maybe one or two votes on the court, not more than that. He's not gonna be able to tip it in 1860. It's not actually up for grabs. Now in 1864, maybe it is. He's had a little chance to make some appointments. Some people have left the court. They were secessionists and other things. And in 1864, that's a fraud election, because you got the tall, skinny constitutional lawyer from Illinois, okay, whose basically record is on the ballot, same as today. And on the other side, and if he's reelected, well, that's one world. And if his opponent is reelected, he's this rich narcissist from New Jersey. He owns a lot of casinos. No, I made that last point up. But George McClellan. Well, you're going to have a very different world if it's George McClellan. Very different world, because he actually, is a friend of Putin's. I mean, he is willing to basically say, well, let's actually hand power, perhaps, or his party, over to the slaveocracy. Well, that's a very different world, you see. And the presidency is on the ballot, and so is the House and the Senate, and the court is on a knife's edge. And the reason that I loathe McClellan is that he was constantly dismissive of Abraham Lincoln, didn't understand greatness when he saw it. And one of the many things I do not like about Trump is how he's been, profoundly dismissive of the tall, skinny constitutional lawyer from Illinois, who is our current president. And just like if you say, well, why is he thinking that this is like that? Do you understand what these two pictures are? This one is the electoral map of 2008, okay? Because Obama in that year carried North Carolina and Indiana, and he didn't, Florida. Now, what's the top one?
1896.
That's Lincoln's coalition against this, and it's pretty similar. Florida's close, you know, it's always close, and, you know, Virginia, North Carolina are close, they're always close. Our country's divided the same way. But here's the thing in the head. That top one, blue, that would be the Republican Party. That's Lincoln's party. Okay? The party's a flip. The tall, skinny constitutional lawyer, you know, from Illinois, who inherits Lincoln's coalition, that would be Barack Obama and the Democrats. And the other party, they become the party of the Confederacy. It's the same division in America. And 1864 was a big one. And you have to go back to that to find a moment when actually until very recently, House, Senate, presidency, and court are all up for grabs in the same election. Because here's what happens. Lincoln wins that one, thank God. And then Andrew Johnson comes along. He doesn't get any appointments to the Supreme Court. And Grant wins with the Tannehill successor and wins again. And then Rutherford B. Hayes. Because the Democrat Party, which was the dominant political party in America before Lincoln, the Republicans had never won. They're only, you know, a five-year-old party. But Andrew Jackson's party, which is the dominant political party in America, in fact, commits suicide because of slavery and secession and segregation, and they are not heard politically for a very long time. They are in the wilderness. And no Democrat gets a majority after Lincoln until Franklin Roosevelt. Woodrow Wilson, not Grover Cleveland, not. So they're never. So who's your Supreme Court? By the time Grant wins twice, and Rutherford B. Hayes, all parts of the Supreme Court, they're all Republicans. And so even if Grover Cleveland wins, and he doesn't win consecutively, he's not going to be able to take the Supreme Court, neither is Woodrow Wilson. So the court is not in play. And then there's a Great Depression, and people blame George W. Bush, I mean, I'm Herbert Hoover, for that. And so the Democrats sweep in, FDR, okay? But he's not going to be able to 32 he has all these Republicans in his first term, the battle of the court. Eventually, he goes again and again and again, and eventually, he puts all the justices on the court, okay? But and so the court is now no longer, so when it's finally Ike's turn, the court's no longer in play. There are nine Democrats in 1952. Now, Ike begins to replenish by 1952. The court's evening up a little bit, but the president's not. Ike looked, how about Stevenson got 11 points the first time around, and now he wins the second one by 15. It's not genuinely in play. And by the time Ike was leaving, the Democrats, as they had for most of the New Deal era, have overwhelming majorities. House or Senate or both, sometimes 2-1 in the House or the Senate. So that's not really in play under John Kennedy. The presidency is a very close run thing in 1960, and maybe the Supreme Court hangs in the balance, but the House and Senate don't. The Democrats are going to win that, and that's going to be true under Lyndon Johnson, and that's going to be true under Richard Nixon, and that's going to be true under Gerald Ford and Jimmy Carter and Ronald Reagan. And H.W. So it's not until the Gingrich Revolution in 1994 that the Congress becomes kind of competitive again when the Republicans take it back. So now actually the Congress is competitive and has been since Bill Clinton, but the Supreme Court wasn't really in play for Bill Clinton because he inherits 8 Republicans and a Democrat. He's not going to, and at the beginning, he's not going to be able to tip that in his first term or even his second, even Al Gore. Now, there's some liberal Republicans on the court then, David Souter, John Paul Stevens, Harry Blackmun, but just from a purely partisan alignment point of view, the court is not in play. You see it when Al Gore. So, when does it basically get in play again? Barack Obama, the tall, skinny constitutional lawyer from Illinois, when he's on the ballot in 2012, yes, it's possible if he had carried the Senate, well, then we'd be talking Justice Merrick Garland right now, and that would be five, that would have been a switch of Democratic, of partisan control. But you, and this election it could be, and you haven't seen that since the age of Lincoln, okay? Because I just went through all the elections between now. That's why this is an extraordinary moment. The other reason is we've never seen anyone like Donald Trump before. We've never had a president with no government experience before. We've only had one real presidential candidate with no government experience before, Wendell Willkie. So this is highly unusual, and we're going to talk about. That's a good segue into presidential selection, which is our specific topic today. And I'm going to tell you what I think, and you're going to push back. That's fine. That's how we do things here. Okay, so let's look at our Constitution together, and let's think about what it says about who's eligible to be president. And there are there's the letter of the Constitution, and then its spirit. So here's the most important stuff in Article 2. And we're talking really about Article 2, Section 1, Paragraph 5 in particular. No person, except a natural-born citizen or a citizen of the United States at the time of the adoption of the Constitution, shall be eligible to the office of the president. Neither shall any person be eligible to that office or shall not have attained to the age of 35 years and been 14 years a resident within the United States. Okay, y'all with me? Now here's some of the most important, so are they all eligible? Yes, formally, of course. Was Ted Cruz eligible? Yes, and I'm happy to tell you why in just a little bit. He is a natural born citizen because it's not where you're born, it's how you're born. You have to be born a citizen of the United States. Doesn't matter whether you're born in Canada or anywhere else, it's when you become a citizen. If you became a citizen on your birthday, then you are a born citizen. The word natural is just, in effect, a reiteration of that from the French naître, to be born. You know, like chapter one of David Copperfield, I am born. Okay, so, and I'll say more about that and why that would be the rule, but Cruz was eligible, and Clinton is eligible, and Trump is eligible, but now, and if that's all we were going to do today, I just wasted your time, because you could have looked at that on your own, and maybe you need a little bit of a primer on natural born, but now, what's behind all of that? You know, the Constitution isn't, it's not just rules, it's, there's a spirit behind it. There are reasons they put these words in the document, and we can learn a lot. Doesn't bind us, but we would be wise to actually study why they did what they did, the framers, and why they omitted what they omitted. So let's start with the omissions, because that's what might not jump out at you. What doesn't it say? That's really significant in their world that anyone reading the document at the time would say, whoa, that's news. Here's what it doesn't say. And by the way, we're going to see now a different picture. This one is actually how America is always basic. This is John Adams against Thomas Jefferson. And we're basically divided as a country, north against south. It's not big states versus small states. This is when you look at it at a county level. There's basically coastal America and the rest. If you're a blue person, it's a red country when it comes to geography. But we'll talk about this one. This is actually a very famous painting. It's called The Washington Family. But what isn't there? Well, here's one thing that's not there. There are no religious qualifications for federal office, for the presidency. And indeed, another clause of the Constitution is going to absolutely prohibit religious tests for office. Does that mean that you can't take religion into account when you're deciding whom to vote for or not? No, of course you can. But the framers of the document actually meant to create a regime in which people of all faiths and indeed of no faith would be eligible. That was big news because every single state except one had religious qualifications for office holding. New York didn't, and in 1787-88 it added it. The only state that didn't have religious qualification for office holding was Virginia. The Bill of Religious Liberty that Madison and Jefferson passed in 1785, and that's merely by a statute that could be repealed the next day. In most of the states, religious qualifications didn't just exist, they were built into the state constitution itself, in almost all the state constitutions. And the federal constitution doesn't say that, and indeed, and elsewhere, it says there can be no formal religious test for, not just for the presidency, but for the judiciary, for the cabinet, for all federal office holders. Stunning stuff. Stunning stuff. Now, that's just the text. Now think about actually our practices. Think about that fellow over there. His name is Abraham Lincoln. And he's not a conventional churchgoer. He's a person of deep faith, but he won't be a hypocrite. He's not going to go if he doesn't believe it, and he doesn't quite accept certain church teachings. Well, there are four guys up on Mount Rushmore. Thomas Jefferson, he's not a conventional churchgoer either. And those are two of our four Rushmore presidents. We do not have religious tests, not just in the text, but in our tradition. That's an important thing. I'm going to come back to it in just a second and tell you what that means for the election season. But my fellow citizens, look at what we've achieved here in America. Four people ran for the presidency and vice presidency the last time around. Because this isn't just about the Constitution 225 years ago, it's the Constitution today. So in our last presidential election, four guys ran for president and vice president. And in a country that was founded by largely mainstream Protestants, that's the demographic reality of America at the founding. Largely mainstream Protestants, of the four guys running, only one was a mainstream Protestant, and his name is Barack Hussein Obama, and his dad was a Muslim. And Joe Biden, you see, he's a Catholic, and there's nothing wrong with that. And Paul Ryan, he's a Catholic, and there's nothing wrong with that. And Mitt Romney, he's a Mormon, and there's nothing wrong with that. And the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints didn't even exist as an organized church at the time of the founding. It's not mainstream Protestant, as it's conventionally defined. And no one made a big deal of that. Thank God that we didn't, actually. That's how far we've come. No Democrat made a big deal about Mitt Romney. The only issue was actually in the Republican primary. And you should hold in low regard a presidential candidate who again and again and again tries to call attention to sectarian identity or lack thereof, who says, you know, about Ben Carson, oh, I don't know about those Seventh-day Adventists, oh, I don't know about that, and who says, I don't know how many evangelicals come from Cuba, which is what he said about Ted Cruz and Marco Rubio, and who wants the birth certificate again and again and again, and just Google this. I'm not making it up. Because he thinks on the birth certificate it might say Muslim for Barack Obama. And that's why Obama didn't want to show it. Calling attention to that. And by the way, you get to choose your religion in America. It's not how you're born. Abraham Lincoln's entire life is a sort of a spiritual journey. He won't be a hypocrite, but Barack Obama is an adult convert Christian. By the way, so am I. But it doesn't matter. We are all Americans. And that's what this test is saying by its omission, and you might miss it, but it's a big deal that it doesn't have a religious qualification. It's a big deal, because that's news in the world. It's an amazing Enlightenment project, and one of the two presidential candidates is trying to divide us along sectarian lines, and shame on him. He's allowed to do it. You can follow it. But it's not keeping with the spirit of the document or our traditions, which include Thomas Jefferson and Abe Lincoln. And the irony of all of this is he's not really, doesn't strike me as someone who's a person of deep faith, truthfully. You know, when he talks about 2 Corinthians, no, it's not 2 Corinthians. 2 Corinthians walked into a bar. No, it's 2 Corinthians. And she doesn't wear it on her sleeve, and I'm admiring that she doesn't, but I was actually at a wedding. I'm with her, with Hillary. And she actually spoke at the wedding, and she actually read a passage from 1 Corinthians 13, and I went up to her afterwards and said, you know, that was the passage that we read at our wedding, you know, about faith, hope, and love, and the greatest of these is love, and what love really is. I'm sure many of you know it. It's a very beautiful passage. Like, she knows the stuff backwards and forwards, but she doesn't wear it on her sleeve, and good for her, because she's trying to avoid dividing us along sectarian lines, and the people, especially of this city, should appreciate that, because more than most places in America, this is a place, from the beginning, always has been, Catholics and Protestants and Dutch Reform and Quakers in the Mid-Atlantic and everyone and no one. Okay. And it's not just the presidency, although this is really about the presidency. Let's talk about the court, since I actually don't think it's the be-all and end-all. Dominant Protestant, mainstream Protestant country at the founding. There are 9 justices before Justice Scalia's passing. None was a mainstream Protestant. 6 Catholics, 3 Jews. And I say that not to call attention to it. I don't want to call attention to it. The point is, you guys didn't notice. Like, we managed without any mainstream Protestants on the court. And if it's Merrick Garland, and we're going to talk about him at a later lecture, very good man. He'd be a 4th Jew. It would be 5 Catholics. Still, no mainstream Protestant. And people are not making a big deal about that. That's a triumph that we've achieved, that we're not divided, you see, along religious lines. And Harry Reid, who was Senate Majority Leader until pretty recently, Mormon. Paul Ryan, as I mentioned before, Catholic. John Boehner before him, Catholic. We're not making a big deal about these things. You know, is Mitch McConnell a Protestant or Catholic? Happens to be Protestant, but who cares? Okay? And you might have just missed that, what's not there. Oh, boy. Okay, that's my first warning. I've got one more, and then... Okay. Doesn't say religion. Doesn't say property. There are no property qualifications for the Constitution, for the presidency. And every state has massive property qualifications for being a governor. You know, in England, if to be chief executive, you have to be king, and we don't have any property qualifications. And many of our presidents have been low-born, self-made people in our history, from Abraham Lincoln, Ulysses Grant, Gerald Ford, Bill Clinton. It's pretty striking, and we should be proud of that, too. George Washington was extremely wealthy, John Adams not so much, and Abe Lincoln born into dirt, like Barack Obama. No name, no money, so what does it say? Well, it says you have to be, so it doesn't say property. And that's pointed because many states had massive property qualifications for being governor. England had brown. Doesn't say religion. You're allowed to be religious. You're allowed to say, so help me God. The text doesn't say that, by the way. It says, I solemnly swear that I shall faithfully execute the office of President of the United States and will, to the best of my ability, preserve, protect, and defend the Constitution of the United States, period. You're allowed to say, so help me God. We don't try to... we're not like the French who try to suppress all public displays of religion. They have a principle called laïcité, secularism, and we don't have that. You're allowed to do that, but that's just people adding that word. George Washington chooses to swear on a Bible, and he's allowed to do that. Let's see if we got a picture of George Washington. Where does Washington take his first inaugural address? Because it's not Washington, D.C., right here in Lower Manhattan, and here he is, and he is swearing on a Bible. He's allowed to do that. But no one's forcing him to do that. In England, in order to be king, you have to swear on a Bible, and not just any Bible. That Douay Catholic Bible doesn't cut it. It has to be a good Protestant King James Bible, and it has to be, the oath has to be administered by a bishop or an archbishop of the Anglican Church, and you have to pledge to be defender of the faith, and you have to say the words, "So help me God," and you have to kiss the book. It's very scripted under the Act of Settlement of 1701. We don't want Catholic heads of state in Britain, but that's not what our regime is. It's a conscious break with all of that, you see. Okay, so why do you have to be 35? What's up with that? Not because they're trying to jam Alexander Hamilton, who's 33. Two reasons. One, they grandfather in everyone who's all, unnatural born. I'm getting ahead of myself. And he's born in Nevis. But it's going to be George Washington for the foreseeable future. So it's not about any existing person. By the time George Washington is ready to leave, you know, all the young people are, so why does the president have to be 35? Well, I'll tell you why. See, 15. Who would have the name recognition to get themselves elected president at the age of 32? What kind of person would that person have to be just to have the name recognition to be elected president? You'd have to be a famous son of a famous father. Or maybe some military figure, some dashing man on a horse. Or an escalator. So how can I prove that to you? Who's the prime minister of England when they come up with that rule? In 1787, they say you got to be 35. Who's the prime minister of England? William Pitt the Younger, who becomes a prime minister, member of parliament at 21 and prime minister at 24, and he might be good and he might be bad, but he's getting it because he has the same first and last name as his daddy, who was prime minister, William Pitt the Elder. This is an anti-dynastic provision. Okay, I'm going to go for, because I did some introduction here, so I'm going to go for five more minutes, and then I'm going to have to stop. And have to let you guys into the conversation. And if you want more, you'll just have to read the book. You don't have to buy it. It's their libraries. Information wants to be free. But our presidency was designed to be anti-dynastic, you see. Why is George Washington father of his country? Well, they tell you why. He tells you why. In the first draft of his inaugural address, he cuts it out. He says, "You can trust me because I don't have any, I'm not going to create a throne because I got no one to give it to. I don't have a son." He becomes father of his country because he's not father of his own children, and everyone understands that at the time. This is the Washington family. Behold, the most important thing is what's not there, just like the qualifications that aren't. Behold a man with no son. There's an emptiness in the middle of this thing. He's got the world at his feet, a globe. He's looking at maps. You know, he's a general. But that's an adopted step-grandson, an adopted step-granddaughter, and there's a certain sadness, and no one's looking at anyone else. This is Edward Savage in the National Archives, the painter. A rising S-U-N in middle of the frame, but no S-O-N. And that's what he's telling you. That's how you read that painting. George Washington can be trusted because he has no son. It's an anti-dynastic provision. Thomas Jefferson, no sons, at least that we know about, legitimate ones, with his name, born on the proper side of the marital bed. James Monroe, no sons. James Madison, no sons. Now, John Adams, you see, he's got a son. And his son is named Q, as in W. And he's eligible to be president, but only after he proves his worth in his own right. 35 is also, you have to show us in your own right what you actually have done. Have a life of actually service that we can actually measure. Service, not self-service. Service to the Republic. That was the idea. And by the time John Quincy Adams is president, well, he's been an ambassador for many years, a very distinguished public servant, Secretary of State, for a very long period, half your secretaries of state become president of the United States. That's how you become president, by being Secretary of State. That's Thomas Jefferson. That's James Madison. That's James Monroe. That's John Quincy Adams. That's Martin Van Buren. That's James Buchanan, may he rot in hell. You know, so it's no guarantee that you're a good one. But fully half the people who are Secretary of State, because presidency is about actually knowing the world, like being able to know on a map what the countries are, you know, and their names, and maybe a little bit about them. And I'm going to prove that to you, and then we're going to break. So it's about 35. By the time Quincy Adams gets elected, he's elected in his own right. He's a track record of his own. They didn't say you're forever ineligible. You might be good at the thing. And this isn't a partisan thing, because I'm nervous about not just the Bushes, but what about the Kennedys, you see? And it's not just the senator from this state, Robert, whose brother was president and who put him in office, you see, and who wants to succeed very shortly after his brother, and the other brother, Ted. But we could talk about, you know, their brother-in-law, Sergeant Shriver, who's on the vice presidential ticket. And we could talk about, the governor of this state isn't just the son of a governor of this state. And the guy, and Andrew Cuomo, you know, he spoke at the Democratic National Convention. It's not just that he's the son of someone who spoke at the Democratic National Convention, very famously, Mario Cuomo. Mario Cuomo, you know, wanted to run for president, and maybe Andrew Cuomo does too. Who's Andrew Cuomo's wife for the first 15 years? Yes, Robert Kennedy's daughter. And who's Arnold Schwarzenegger's spouse? Well, that would be Maria Shriver, whose dad was Sergeant Shriver, whose uncle was Jack Kennedy, whose uncle was Ted Kennedy, whose uncle was Robert Kennedy. And since I'm talking about California, Edmund G. Brown Jr., who's the current governor, Jerry Brown, is the son of Edmund G. Brown Sr., and they actually were warning us about dynasty, and we're seeing that in our midst. Mitt Romney's father ran for the presidency of the United States, born outside the United States, by the way. And maybe in the Q&A we can talk about, you know, the natural born stuff. George Romney ran for president, born outside the United States. And Trump's father didn't run for, and Al Gore's father is a senator, you see. And George W. Bush, it's not just that he's the son of a president with the same first and last name. He's the grandson of a senator and the brother of a big state governor, and the state was Florida. So we are seeing dynasties arise in our midst, and this is on the Republican side and the Democrat side. Well, what about Trump and Clinton? And you might think Clinton is very dynastic, but she's not born into anything. They marry each other. Chelsea would be dynastic, but whether adoptive horizontal unions, and neither of them was wealthy when they were born. They made a ton. So did George Washington. Donald Trump inherits his wealth and power and name. She doesn't. She's adopted by him. They partner up. Who else partners up? Well, that would be Thomas Jefferson picking James Madison as his sort of protege to carry his flag forward. Who does George Washington pick? Who's George Washington's, you know, protege, whom he picks to carry his flag forward? You've seen that play. It's Alexander Hamilton. And some people even say, have you heard the rumor? Alexander Hamilton is actually the bastard son, the illegitimate son of George Washington. People say that. You know, I haven't seen the birth certificate. Have you seen the birth certificate? And they say that because Hamilton has no father. He's the bastard brat of Scott Peddler, and Washington has no son, and they're concerned about sort of dynastic succession and rule. It's preposterous, because George Washington is 6'3", and Alexander Hamilton not so much. But it has just enough plausibility, you see, because they're obsessed in that era by dynasty, and you should be too. And there are different kinds of dynasties. But Trump, he's an American aristocrat. He is the Donald, as in the Earl, the Duke, the Baron. His son is named Baron, the youngest one. Inherits wealth and power. She doesn't. So you have to think about, well, what kind of dynasties are problematic and why and how, because they are asking you to do that. Natural born, and then I'll just, what was the rule about natural born? here's what the rules. This is an anti-aristocratic, it's an egalitarian constitution, no property qualifications, no religious qualifications. 35 is about dynasty. So is natural born. They were afraid that a foreign-born duke or earl would come over to the United States with a huge boatload of gold and a huge posse of a retinue and buy an American election, which didn't have campaign finance rules. They were worried about the Bishop of Osnaburg, the second son of George III coming over. That's actually what natural born is all about when you read the context. And I'll give you some, there's more discussion of that. Finally, what's about this? Here's one thing about 14 years, and then I'll stop. It's not 14 years of continuous service, you see. Why not? Because they want their presence to go abroad and understand what the world is. As John Adams does, as Thomas Jefferson does, as John Quincy Adams does. And I told you, half the secretaries of state who serve for 4 years become president, and the ones who don't come this close: Daniel Webster, Henry Clay, in the 20th century, really in epic people, George Marshall, George C. Marshall, and others. So what's their vision of the presidency? Someone who has service to the nation, a track record in his own right. We are not focused on religion. We're not focused on whether the person is wealthy or not. We do want them to understand the world. And we do want them to be people of real service. And we are nervous about people who are basically born with wealth and power and fame. We were nervous about. And that's why we want to make sure you have a track record of your own. And we give lower-born people a chance to shine. So who's Hillary most like? I don't think she's most like the high-born governor. She's a New Yorker. We got two New Yorkers running, of course, which is why it's so amazing that we're here. I don't think she's most like the high-born Andrew Cuomo or the high-born Nelson Rockefeller of this state, or the high-born Franklin Roosevelt of this state, or to pick other high-born people, Jack Kennedy, Bobby Kennedy, Ted Kennedy, Jerry Brown, Jeb Bush, George W. Bush, George H.W. Bush, whose father was a senator. They're all born, very high up. She's kind of adopted. The New Yorker that she's most like is Alexander Hamilton. Who was highly controversial, a lightning rod, a policy wonk. Washington basically adopts him, and partners up with him. That's why I think for one of the advertisements for this, I said, it's like Washington and Hamilton or Jefferson and Madison with sex. So it is more complicated because of that, and because of Chelsea. And we should be talking about all those things. We absolutely should. And we're not the only society in the world that has these issues. That's India, that's the Philippines, that's Indonesia, that's many other societies. Okay, I went on for longer than I had hoped. It's your turn now to ask questions. We're going to talk about a lot over the course of this series, but in particular about presidential rules of eligibility. So questions or comments? Thank you.
Okay, let's get back to Ted Cruz. Because you brought him up. When that whole thing was happening and Trump kept saying that he wasn't eligible, it seemed very curious to me that Ted Cruz didn't come forward with why he proclaimed himself natural born. Even though I'm not a lawyer and certainly not involved with constitutional law, I let my fingers do the walking and I tried to look up what does it mean to be natural born. And I have it all written down on my phone, which I don't happen to have with me, but my recollection was something like, if both of your parents are American, and there was some question about Ted Cruz's father not becoming a citizen until after Ted Cruz was born, which I think might have disqualified him, especially if his parents were not married. And I think it might have been embarrassing for him to come forward and say, I am natural born, because it might have come out that he, I don't know what the facts are, but perhaps he's a bastard child, and that would disqualify him. And you probably know a lot about this.
So natural born doesn't mean in wedlock or out of wedlock. It doesn't mean, you know, not a C-section. It's not like Macbeth, be bloody bold and resolute, laugh to scorn the power of man, for none of woman born shall harm Macbeth. And he quotes that, and Macduff says, despair thy charm and let the dark angel whom thou still serves know that Macduff was from his mother's womb untimely ripped. It's not about that. It's not about like Shakespeare's C-sections or verses. It's about when you become a citizen. There are two options. You can be born a citizen on the day that you're born. You're a born citizen. Just forget the word natural. You're just a born citizen. Or you can become a citizen thereafter. That's called naturalized, treated, and that's when, if you're not a citizen on the day of your birth. Now, how do we decide whether you're a citizen on the day of your birth? We have to look to the existing law, the law that was on the books, the congressional statute, about who is a citizen on the day of their birth. And that law has changed over the years. I'm going to read you, actually, from this about Ted Cruz. So, George Romney. Where's George Romney born? Is he eligible? Well, we need to know what the law, the congressional law was on the day that he's born. And the law at the time says if you're two American citizen parents, you're a citizen no matter where you're born. Where's John McCain born? Panama Canal Zone. Now, is that the United States or not? It doesn't matter if he'd born in Timbuktu. He's a child of two American citizens who, by the way, were serving our country. It would be terrible. If we said people who serve our country, ambassadors, admirals, soldiers, their children somehow are forever ineligible, that would not be a good rule. And unless the words imperiously require it, we should not have that as a rule. If the voters don't want to vote for them, they don't have to vote for them. But we shouldn't actually, lightly render people ineligible. Here are the constitutional principles. To the extent the text is ambiguous, we should try to treat everyone equally, and we should let voters choose if the text is ambiguous. Now, here's actually what the congressional statute on the day Ted Cruz was born said. It says, if you're born outside the United States and one of your parents is a U.S. citizen who has spent a certain number of years in the United States, that's good enough. And his mother was a U.S. citizen on the day he's born, and she had been in the United States forever, so that's easy. Now, here's the interesting question. By the way, if you're interested in this, it's page 38 of the book, bottom. Suppose, it's preposterous, but suppose Barack Obama had been born in Kenya. How is he different from Cruz under the statute? His mother is a U.S. citizen. His father's not. Cruz's father's not. So why is it any different? Because here's the wrinkle. The rule of residency said your citizen parent had to be 5 years resident in the United States after the age of 14. Cruz's mom is old. She meets that. Obama's mom on the day he's born is 18 years old. So she couldn't have been 5 years in the United States. So he had to be born, as he was born, Donald Trump, in Hawaii, which is in the United States, Donald Trump, last time I checked. But you have to look at the congressional statutes. They changed over time, and it's a very simple and easy question. On the day that you were born, were you an American citizen? For Ted Cruz, yes. Okay.
Thank you.
One of the exceptions that isn't listed here is gender, mm-hmm. and women were not allowed to vote in the national election
yep.
until the 19th Amendment. Was there some attitude or feeling about that, or was Abigail Adams, could she have been a...
So, wonderful question, and you see, this is a little bit like a magic show because you're going to ask me questions and I'm going to have a picture for every one of them. Here are women crusading for the vote. I love the baby stroller. Where's that parade? That's Broadway, okay? And it says he, him, his. And they always wonder about whether presidents are going to be like kings, and no one asks if a president's going to be like a queen. And they know from queens, Elizabeth, is the Virgin Queen. Virginia's named after that. William and Mary is named after another queen. So you could say, oh, a president has to be a man, but it doesn't quite say that. But there's a possible argument it does. But at a minimum, a woman doesn't have a right to run for president. They didn't vote except in New Jersey. So if a state passed a law saying women can't be on the ballot in 1800, well, that wouldn't be much of a, you know, that wouldn't be so striking. Women aren't on the ballot. They can't vote. How can they run? So that's a constitutional law. Even if you say they are eligible, a state, if it wants to, can say we're not putting them on the ballot at the founding. Well, what about today? Well, here's my claim. We're going to come to this later in the book, in a later lecture. The 19th Amendment is about women voting. And not just voting, but the right to be voted for. The right of women to vote for women. The right of women to vote in a referendum, and not just for a candidate. To vote in the legislature, and not just, you know, at an ordinary election. The president is part of the legislature through the veto process. It's the right to serve in government, the right of women to be voted for by other women, the right to be voted for. The 19th Amendment idea is that women have equal political rights, and so now a state can't do any of that, and I can prove that to you. One political cartoon. Here's what it says. He says, not guilty. Here's the caption. Women are too sentimental for jury service. Dash, anti-suffrage argument. You see, all the men, and they're sentimental too. What's the date of that? It's 1916. What are people thinking about in 1916? That would be women's suffrage. Here's what this person is saying. When women get the right to vote, they will also have a right to vote in a jury box. They will have a right to vote in a legislature. They will have a woman's place will now no longer be, you know, a woman's place is in the House. It's going to be in the House, yes, and the Senate. And the White House. And now that's going to transform the nature of the first lady position, because it's not as if women suddenly became smart in 1920. Abigail Adams was a political operative. She was just like Hillary. She was his right hand, but she's never going to succeed John. And Dolly Madison was a brilliant political operative, and she's never going to succeed James Madison. And I promise you that Mary Lincoln was a very politically savvy spouse. She had some issues on certain things, but she's amazing politico. And realistically, Mary Lincoln's never going to be president, and Abigail Adams is never going to be president, Martha Washington is never going to be president, and Dolly Madison is never going to be president. And now, when you have the 19th Amendment, a president has two running mates. He's got the vice president who could succeed him, you know, and actually, he's got Bill Clinton has Al Gore, and he has Hillary Clinton. We've changed the role of the first lady. So now, we have these tag teams where Eleanor Roosevelt is out there in a way that Abigail wasn't, because she's appealing to women voters. He can appeal to the moderates, she can appeal to the crusaders, two for the price of one, and that's after the 19th Amendment. That's Franklin and Eleanor, that's Bill and Hillary, that's Barack and Michelle. I wouldn't have been shocked if Michelle had run. I wouldn't. She's, you know, because that's a different one. The president has two running mates now. And that, because you have to pick someone who's going to succeed you, okay? And Jefferson picks Madison. And Washington picks Hamilton. Nothing succeeds like succession. This guy, Abraham Lincoln, picked, in effect, Ulysses S. Grant. Franklin Roosevelt picks his handpicked successor, but today the handpicked successor could be your vice president or your spouse in a way that it really couldn't be before the 19th Amendment. The 19th Amendment transforms the nature of women's political participation.
First things first, before I go into my question, I need to offer you my deepest gratitude for your coming here and doing this. Thanks. For the city of New York, the people, for me. This is incredibly important, what you're doing. It's sorely needed by the citizens, and I thank you. My question. Since 1787, since the Constitutional Convention, we have been analyzing and arguing over the meaning that the framers have given every word and even every punctuation mark within the Constitution. My question to you, is there any sort of insight other than the outcome itself of what the framers were thinking when they were sitting inside Independence Hall? Were there minutes taken of the Constitutional Convention or notes or anything left behind that scholars such as yourself were able to comb through?
There were, and because the rule was it was supposed to be secret, Madison took a whole bunch of notes that he'd not published until his death, and he was actually the last one to die. And he didn't think we should use his notes basically to decide how to interpret the law, because people in the year where they ratified didn't have access to this. He thought they might be of historical significance, but not of legal significance. There's a new book out by Mary Sarah Bilder. It's called Madison's Hand, in which she says she thinks that Madison changed the notes for political purposes in the years sort of after and the months after the Philadelphia Convention. But there are a bunch of sets of notes. Madison's are the most comprehensive. But still, he's just jotting down only a small portion of all the things that are said. But the Constitution becomes law, you see, because the people ratify it, not because of what happened in Philadelphia. And our Constitution isn't just the original Constitution, because in that Constitution, women don't have a right to vote, and so there's no Hillary Clinton. And it's not a partisan thing. Sarah Palin, you know, doesn't have a right, an absolute right to run for the vice presidency, or Michelle Bachmann doesn't have an absolute right to run for the vice presidency. The 19th Amendment changes things. The 15th Amendment says black people have a right to vote and be voted for, and without that, you don't have President Barack Obama. How do we get the 15th? Because we got the 14th. How do we get the 14th? Because we got the 13th. How do we get the 13th? Because of that guy over there, Abraham Lincoln, who single-handedly, exactly. Presidents are powerful. Here are the biggest constitutional decisions of all time. Louisiana Purchase is pretty big. Lincoln's decision to resist unilateral secession by force of arms, that's the biggest, because otherwise there's no United States today. And then the Emancipation Proclamation, which is executive power on steroids, executive order. Those are the biggest constitutional decisions of all time, and they're going to lead to the 13th and the 14th and the 15th. And it's because of those amendments, which the founders knew not, that you get maybe President Hillary Rodham Clinton. You've got already President Barack Hussein Obama. So don't confuse what the Philadelphia folks agreed to with what the people ratified. And don't confuse in 1787-88 what the people ratified with our current Constitution, because our current Constitution contains all these amendments that have made amends for some of the sins of the founding fathers. We added a Bill of Rights, a 13th Amendment abolishing slavery, a 14th. And we're going to talk about all of that, I promise you, in future lectures, if you come and bring your friends, please. But the 14th Amendment promising a birth equality to all. Everyone born in America is born a citizen and an equal citizen. All are born equal. All are created equal. That's his reinterpretation of Jefferson. And the 15th Amendment, voting rights for blacks. And the 19th Amendment, voting rights for women. And in my lifetime, voting rights for young adults, 18-year-olds. So don't confuse Philadelphia with the original Constitution. Don't confuse the original Constitution with our Constitution. Because in our Constitution, you see, I can't say I'm with her. Because, yes, maybe she could be allowed to run, but she wouldn't have a right to run. Our Constitution, she has a right to run. So don't try any funny business, North Carolina, whatever. You can't pull that.
I wanted to introduce the issue of territorial extension,
yes.
How big a country is, which may seem strange because people who are born or who live in a big country, they are used to it and it becomes normal. But in the 18th century, Montesquieu, who was maybe the guy that most of the founding fathers read, used to say that big countries cannot be republics. They have to be monarchies or empires.
So it's a great question, and I want to get everyone in. That's not the question for today's lecture quite so much, although presidents are national security commander-in-chief figures. It is a central question in chapter one of a book that I wrote in 2005 called America's Constitution, A Biography. I'm happy to talk with you afterwards about it,
no, but
I want to hang on, because we have to get everyone here involved before the end. So I'll talk to you about it offline. In America's Constitution, a biography, chapter one, I talk a lot about the size of America. Now, here is one thing, because we do have to talk about Lincoln. Why does he insist that a state can't unilaterally secede? You know, maybe, wouldn't we, you might think, we'd be better off, you know, without those guys. Let them go. You know, what was Lincoln thinking? You know, they're just pains in the butt. Well, when I'm a kid, we got to the moon. And we didn't sell rights to it, you know. And we didn't say it's only for us Americans and not for the Mexicans and, you know, and not for, we came in peace for all mankind. Pretty amazing stuff. And what's the first word spoken on the lunar surface? First word, not by Neil Armstrong when he steps foot, one small step for a man, one giant leap for mankind. When the lunar module lands, the first word spoken on the lunar surface is Houston. Houston, Tranquility Base here, the Eagle has landed. It's hard to throw rockets up into space, so I'm glad we have Houston and Cape Canaveral and these other places. We win World War II and bring democracy to the world because this guy unilaterally, Marbury versus Madison is nothing. Original versus appellate jurisdiction, mandamus, who the hell cares? Resisting unilateral secession by force of arms and holding the country together, that was a big one, and he was right, and I'll tell you more about that, but I hope I've said enough now because I want to get three other friends into the conversation. But that's chapter one of America's Constitution, a biography. Yeah, please.
Yes, Professor, I wonder if you're familiar with the idea that the Fifth Amendment prohibits discrimination based on national origin.
Yes.
And therefore, the Fifth Amendment overrides the Natural Born Citizen Clause so that, in fact, someone who was theoretically not natural born under the Fifth Amendment actually could run for president. Are you familiar
with
that?
Yeah, I don't really think that Arnold Schwarzenegger is eligible. I don't think that Henry Kissinger is eligible, or Madeleine Albright, or my friend Jennifer Granholm, because they are not citizens on the day of their birth. But here's where I do agree with you. Because the Constitution is really clear, and if you want to change something that's really clear, you got to be equally clear, and the 14th Amendment isn't equally clear. The 14th Amendment, the passage you're referring to, says, and I can talk about this later on, nothing about voting and political rights, in fact. The court has read it, but in fact, that's preposterous. Because if it were about voting rights, you wouldn't have needed a 15th Amendment. You wouldn't have needed a 19th Amendment. You know, if basically people have rights to vote under Section 1 of the 14th Amendment. I don't want to go into that in great detail today. Here's what I will say, and it's apropos. I told you the Constitution isn't just the original, it's amendments. The amendments aren't over. We can add to them. Maybe we should add to them. Here are some maybe that we could. Should we change the Electoral College? Well, maybe we should. Should we add an ERA? You know, I think we already have an implicit one in the Constitution, but maybe it'd be good to say it again once more with feeling. Gandhi was once asked what he thought of Western civilization. He paused. He said, "I think it would be a good idea." And I think an ERA would be a good idea. And I think, and I talk about this in the last chapter of America's Unwritten Constitution, we should add an amendment allowing people who come by the rules, contribute, they're not citizens on the day of their birth, but they serve the country, they should be eligible. Their fellow citizens should be able to exalt them to the highest spot. America should be a land where everyone can grow up to be more than merely governor. Now, there was an amendment proposed to say all of this. I was invited to testify on behalf of it. You will never guess who sponsored that amendment.
Orrin Hatch?
Orrin Hatch of Utah, conservative Republican, and God bless him, and I'm with him, and one day, Trump and Trumpism, I hope this too will pass, this demonization of our of aliens. And when it does, when the Republican Party regains its sanity, Orrin Hatch is going to propose that amendment again, and I will be right there with him saying, let's do it. Please.
Yes, hi. So you say Hillary has no dynastic ties to, like, you know, I mean, she came up from Hardscrabble,
yeah,
WASP, and everything, as so did Bill. But she does. There is such a thing as class in America, and
yep,
she does serve the 99%.
Yep.
I mean, the 1%. She does not serve the one, the 99%. And the Constitution was not a popular document at the time. It was kind of a coup d'etat against what most people wanted to keep, 13 separate entities. And so the Constitution was a way of in keeping that going, the class domination, and also they knew that if they hung together, they could exploit the whole continent and maybe even possibly dominate the world. And their plan is coming to fruition, and Hillary is part of it. I've been reading the history. Bruce Ellis is talking about that. And so I'm an advocate for Jill Stein. I want third party like Abraham Lincoln, because the two-party system is not in the Constitution. And the Democrats have tricked and screwed us over for I don't know how long. And Hillary is really not much better than Trump.
I like this, all of those points. I agree with some of them and disagree with others. And I'll tell you, you know, because I've actually written on every one of those points. So I'll actually give you the answer, but I can't do it in 30 seconds. But I can tell you where it is in the books, and you can go to the library and read them. So, was the Constitution in part adopted so that we could be hegemons in our hemisphere, kick the Brits out, kick the Spanish out, kick the French out, kill the Indians, control the continent, manifest destiny, Monroe Doctrine, and no one would screw with us? Yes. That's chapter one of America's Constitution, a biography, which is partly the answer to why actually you want a big republic and not a small one. Because small ones, you know, can't basically kill enough enemies. Now, does that make sense today? No, because when the founders did that, no one in the world, except for the Brits a little bit and the Swiss, are democracies. Everyone, they're thugs, kings, emperors, zans, sultans, Mughal lords, tribal chieftains. So we're in a very dangerous world, but that's not our world today. The world is becoming increasingly American. They're following our model, democracy, because we succeeded, because we won World War II, because we defeated Nazism and fascism and Soviet communism, and we got people to the moon. So yes, that was a big part of the project, and you know who understood all of that? Abraham freaking Lincoln, who unites us east and west with the Transcontinental Railroad as well as north-south, and I'm with him. And I'm with the person who was most like him at the founding, this low-born bastard brat of a Scott peddler, born in the middle of nowhere, born not in the United States, named Hamilton. So I'm in that tradition, and proudly so. So on that, I believe in national greatness. And Hillary does, and so does Trump. Okay. Was it anti-democratic? No. Charles Beard said so. He was full of it. Howard Zinn said so. He's full of it. And I give you the evidence for this in chapter one of America's Constitution, a biography. David Greenstein told you more people got to vote on the Constitution than ever been allowed to vote for anything in the history of planet Earth. I've already given you evidence. There's no property qualifications to be president. None to be a member of the House of Representatives, by the way, or Senate, or Supreme Court. There's lots of evidence, and Beard and Zinn are simply wrong on the facts. So is it a big, stinky, geostrategic power play? Yes. Are the Indians going to get screwed? Yes. Is this about the property people? No. Alexander Hamilton is low-born, and Abraham Lincoln is low-born, and lots of these folks are, so I don't think that is so. What about our two-party system? Our two-party system is built into the Constitution as a practical matter. There's a whole chapter in a book called America's Unwritten Constitution. It's chapter 10, and it's called America's Partisan Constitution, and it explains why we have a two-party system, and that's fine. You don't have to buy it, but you're just wasting your vote, and if you do that, you know, I just got, you know, one phrase for you, President George W. Bush, because people like you in Florida voted for Ralph Nader, and if there's no difference between Gore and Bush, fine, but if there is a difference, you just elected George W. Bush.
All right, okay. Zinn and Beard were right. Vote for Jill Stein. Screw you.
So, I'm giving you evidence for what I believe, and I haven't said screw anyone here. And, you know, we have to actually, you can push back, but I don't think, you know, and I'll be rude to Trump because he really, I have to call him out. He has power, and we must recognize the threat he poses to some of these values of religious toleration, and birth equality. But if there's no difference between them, if you really think that, fine. That's what a lot of people said as between Al Gore and George W. Bush, and they regretted it the month after Bush versus Gore And I know that because I was there, and I'm going to talk at great length about Bush versus Gore in later lectures. So I don't think that they're the same. And I don't think Jill Stein has the track record of service to be president of the United States. It's a throwaway vote. And someone who doesn't know where Aleppo is or what Aleppo means cannot be president of the United States. That's a throwaway vote. So either you're serious, and if you're serious, it's a choice between these two, and you can choose to say, screw you, you know, 1%, all the rest, or you can be grown up about the thing and say, these are our choices, this is our world, and actually, it's sometimes a choice between not so great and God help us.
I read last week that the election, the Constitution says the election can be postponed for up to 2 years. Is that true?
No.
Okay. Good. I happened to read that in Newsday on Long Island by a pretty well-respected columnist. He's saying the election can be postponed for 2 years, and the current president remains in office for 2 years.
No, and here's one of the most amazing things, and here we end. In case you missed it, this is Abraham Lincoln here. And over there. And among the amazing, and what election did I tell you is most like this one? I said it's the election of 1864. We are in the middle of, this is actually the Gettysburg Address. 47 years ago, our fathers, you know, brought forth on this continent a new nation. They don't say conceive for the 1% or anything like that. So Lincoln is just, he's clueless. If he actually, you know, if that other fellow was right, conceived in liberty and dedicated to the proposition that all men are created equal. Now we are engaged in a great civil war, testing whether this nation or any nation so conceived and so dedicated can long endure. Okay, that's, and so he understands that we're in the middle of this great war about whether democracy can work, because it's failed in all of the European countries, 1840s. And we're the last best hope of Earth. And we're in the middle of a civil war, and you know what Abraham Lincoln does? He holds an election fair and square on, you know, on schedule. It's epic that we do that. The Brits don't do that. In a parliamentary system, you can actually modify the election. You can postpone it. You can have it early or late. No, we have a fixed electoral calendar. Every 2 years for the House, every 4 years for the presidency. It's a staggered six-year system. And that's hardwired into it. And we hold elections from hell or high water, you know, terror or trauma. He held an election fair and square. And we did that in World War II. And the Brits, you know, it's not a bad system, but the Brits, no one ever voted for Churchill. They cancel all elections between 1935 and 1945. No one under the age of 30, Churchill says on October 31st, 1945, he says, no one under the age of 30 has ever been allowed to vote in a parliamentary election or even a by-election. They can do that in Britain. They can't do that in the United States, although I will tell you next week's lecture, in chapter 2 of this book, does talk about how, here's one thing we could do. We could actually structure it so that if Donald Trump wins, he gets the keys to the White House the week after the election, and we don't have to wait 2 months. And George W. Bush could have done that for Barack Obama, and I show you how that could be done. I call it InstaGov, because in Britain, immediately after Gordon Brown loses and David Cameron is elected, Cameron moves in to Downing Street immediately. And here, it's November, it's December, it's January, back when this guy won. It's not just January, it's February and March. And what happens? James Buchanan, may he rot in hell, allows the strategic situation to deteriorate. He does nothing at all, and that's a problem, because Lincoln was elected, but he can't do anything. And it's a problem when we're in the middle of this Great Depression and Herbert Hoover does nothing, even after he's been decisively repudiated by FDR. And it's now November, December, January, February. The Constitution is amended to move it up. Originally, it's March 3rd, and there's an amendment moving up to January 20th, but we could do it even earlier. In 2008, George W. Bush, in effect, was on the ballot. He was repudiated. OK? Okay? Incumbents are always on the ballot. This is an election about Barack Obama, about Abraham Lincoln, the tall, skinny constitutional lawyer from Illinois. And it's his handpicked successor that you're basically voting for. And, you know, so George W. Bush, in effect, was on the ballot. He was repudiated in November, and the economy was in free fall, and he had no mandate at all. We wait for November, we wait for December, and for 3 weeks in January. There are ways to accelerate that, but we can't just postpone elections. We are America, we do elections. That's what we do here.